Hi, this is Gerardo Valero, and today I'd like to tell you about great cinematic experiences that don't really come from great movies. I'm talking about those guilty pleasures we know as disaster films. Now, this is a genre that came out some 40 years ago, and after a few hits and misses, eventually ran its course. That is until the 1990s when a few Roland Emmerich films and Armageddon came along, and movies which I cannot say that I connect to. Perhaps because they reflect a change on taste from today's audience. Perhaps because they also show a preference of Hollywood of noise over story. A point-by-point comparison of both periods may just help us figure out what I'm talking about. Firsthand, the characters in the 70s disaster films really took their dilemmas very seriously, a few times a little bit too much. But part of the fun for me was never knowing for sure who was going to live and who was going to die. Sure, you knew firsthand that no children would perish. A disaster movie rule that stands all the way until today, and that made the Poseidon Adventure one very childless cruise. But part of the success of the Poseidon Adventure was allowing two of its most beloved characters, the Gene Hackman and the Shelley Winters one, perish at the dismay of the audience, but to the benefit of its legacy. Today's disaster movie characters are very different. In the recent 2012, we can remember the part where all the main players are in a limousine escaping from the end of the world. And if you remember, you'll agree, perhaps, that they all seem to be acting as if they were on one exciting, long roller coaster ride. Now, most of the characters from today's disaster movies seem to be all divorced and estranged from their families, and almost like waiting for one worthy catastrophe so that they can try to get together again. If you remember the recent 2012, there was a part when the John Cusack and Amanda Pitt characters suddenly start warming up to each other, and at that moment you'll agree with me perhaps that it was no mystery that the role of the current husband was just about doom period. Now, concerning special effects, it is obvious that in the last few years they have advanced tremendously. But in the second part of 2012, I looked at the screen and the only thing that came into mind was something like, look at all the digital water. On contrast, in all movies like The Poseidon Adventure and The Towering Inferno, we know that the only thing they used for special effects were models and real water and real fire. Does that mean that those special effects were better than today's? Of course not. But at least there was no point on those movies when I took my eyes off the screen and, you know, started wondering whether what I was looking at seemed convincing enough. Now, I can remember the first time I saw the Poseidon Adventure many years ago, when during the intermission I looked at my brother who had seen the movie previously and just asked him to tell me straight who lived and who died, because I couldn't take it anymore. That of course wasn't the case when I watched recently 2012, and I don't think kids in schools today are discussing those movies like I used to when I was their age. And I don't think that's going to happen until somebody realizes that unless we watch one of these movies and are able to identify with the characters on the screen and the dilemmas, until then, we'll keep on saying the famous words, they sure don't make those lousy disaster films like they used to. And now, before finishing this segment, I'm going to propose another suggestion for Ebert's little movie glossary, and it's called The Heroic but Disapproving Movie Daddy. And it's concerning, in any disaster film that you watch, if there is a father who disapproves of his daughter's boyfriend, eventually there will be a point when the father will sacrifice his life so that their love and their lives can continue. Just think of Bruce Willis in Armageddon and Kurt Russell in Poseidon. Thanks again. And until next time, el balcón está cerrado.